And to those of you whom are visiting us this morning, we are honored that you chose to praise God with us on this beautiful autumn morning. Thank you to all the individuals who have put a lot of love and detail into preparing for this morning's worship. Thank you. We feel blessed to have the Reverend Scott Matheny, Chaplain and Dean of Religious Life at Elmhurst, University, and a friend, a great friend to this community of faith. Thank you, Reverend Matheny, for being with us this morning. Our mission board wanted me to extend a big thank you to everyone who gave towards the Neighbors in Need collection that ended last week. If you missed an opportunity to give to such a worthy cause, there are envelopes on the hospitality table, which you can take home and mail in or bring to the church at another time. Thank you for your generous giving. As the season of autumn unfolds, and boy, isn't it unfolding? Yes, I extend an invitation to all the ladies in the house to join us for our Autumn Women's Spiritual Growth Gathering. It will be taking place this Friday, October 14th, in our beautiful parlor from 6:30 to 8:30. The evening will consist of a presentation from Maria Castro, a philanthropist, author, and a woman of faith that's making a difference. There will be delicious appetizers, one of my favorites, sweets, raffles, and much more. I hope that you ladies will come out and be part of our time together this Friday. This morning's worship service includes a gospel concert. This celebration and gift of gospel songs led by our director, Jim Molina, and the chancel choir is a special way of singing to our God in the one and most sacred spiritual forms of praising gospel music. So we are delighted for your gift this morning. Thank you. And now, let us prepare ourselves for worship.
Good morning.
Please rise if you're able and join us for our opening hymn, number 561, It Is Well With My Soul.
Thank you.
now, as you remain standing, remember that no matter how it is shared, passing the peace of Christ is more important than ever in our world. Even a simple wave can remind us that we follow and share in the same way Jesus did, saying, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Join me in sharing the wave.
We gather this morning, this amazingly beautiful day. I hope that you will also hold in your hearts and minds across the street. Our Episcopal family across the street is celebrating their 160th anniversary year. It's a wonderful moment. I remember their 150, so my age. but there's so much to be thankful for in this beloved congregation. There's so much. And in that, you indulged me in singing "It Is Well With My Soul" again last week and this week. The prayers of the people, our prayers, are rooted in the notion of wholeness, which you'll hear a lot about in the text. But beloved, in all the ways that we have gathered, let us join our hearts together in prayer. Let us pray. Center us down, almighty and gracious one, into wholeness. For you, who are the author of our lives, the giver of all good things, we hold before you now perspectives. The perspectives of how, in the inevitable life's walkings, life's callings, life's givings, that we ignore the dimension of the quest for wholeness, that we embrace. We know that in our ways we are called and loved. Loved and forgiven by you and guided by you. Always towards wholeness. Always, regardless of our situation in life. Because you understand the perplexity and the paradoxes of life. And our own imperfections. And in that we see hope, joy, grace, power. And so in wholeness, gracious one, give us a sense that we might choose love. For our prayer is really simple. May we choose love, gracious God, may we choose love when faced with retaliation, choosing love when temptation lures us into deception, love when addressing poverty, love when speaking to our neighbors, love when hatred lurks with bad choices, love when electing our leadership. In all these things that we do, in words and deeds, may we find a place to go that is centered in wholeness. For it is in that name of wholeness that you give us this time. For as Christ has given himself to us, we are allowed the grace to walk in love and to try again, because we are not alone. And we hold that in this prayer, we know that you weep for our fractured lives, and you inspire us to heal our hurting. Help us with the cracks that have breached all boundaries. Help us to guide us into that love where everyone stands together. Help us when we search for justice for ourselves, our world, our communities in Elmhurst, that we might find in the midst of that search wholeness, shalom, peace, and power, that in our ways here we might walk as Christ walks. And in these ways we begin to understand what it means to pray. Pray the way Christ taught his disciples then, and calls us by wholeness and love to pray together those words that Jesus taught his disciples, and then Jesus teaches us, we, his disciples, as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. It's my joy to invite Rob to come up and read the text. Please, Rob.
Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles who I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat what they produce, take wives and have sons and daughters, take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters, multiply there and do not decrease. But seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile. Pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare. The second reading is from Luke, chapter 17, verses 11 to 19. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. When he saw them, he said to them, go and show yourselves to the priests. As they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself before Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. And Jesus asked, were not 10 made clean? So where are the other 9? Did none of them return to give glory to God except this foreigner? And then he said to him, go up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well. Today ends the reading.
One of the joys of my wonderful appointment for a lot of years here in New York is the joy of students, and to be able to talk and to think and to laugh and to cry. as I was meeting with him earlier this week, I said, you're going to go to church, yes? And, good. And would you read the text in Spanish, your first language? And I thought it would be helpful. It's always good to hear the scripture in a different language and songs in different languages, because it sort of opens up something that maybe isn't there. Now, some of us know Spanish. I don't know it that well. My Portuguese is so old, it's kind of a joke. But Carlos has agreed to read the gospel in Spanish. So listen for the word of God as it comes to us.
Yendo Jesús a Jerusalén, pasaba entre Samaria y Galilea. Al entrar en una aldea, le salieron al encuentro 10 hombres leprosos, los cuales se pararon de lejos y alzaron la voz, diciendo, Jesús, Maestro, ten misericordia de nosotros. Cuando él los vio, les dijo, id, mostraos a los sacerdotes. Y aconteció que mientras iban, quedaron limpios. Entonces uno de ellos, viendo que había sido sanado, volvió glorificando a Dios a gran voz, y se postró rostro en tierra a sus pies dándole gracias. Este era samaritano. Jesús le preguntó, ¿no son 10 los que han quedado limpios? ¿Y los 9, dónde están? ¿Hubo quien volviera y diera gloria a Dios sino este extranjero? Y le dijo, levántate, vete, tu fe te ha salvado.
Amén. Thank you, Carlos. So part of my joy is also getting asked crazy questions. And not Carlos, but another student this week sort of challenged me and said, so why do you go to church, Scott? And this was not a snarky question. This wasn't a shot. It was a real life, why do you go? And so we rattled back and forth some things. I talked a little bit about community, fellowship, worship, something that transcends and kind of gets me out of this little space that I'm in. And gets me up into some other place or down somewhere. It's a place to pause. A chance to think. Hopefully, sermon helps people think, God forbid. And it helps us also to say, feel. So something about feeling. And kind of integrating the brokenness that, well, I won't assume you, but my crazy brokenness of life into something that might make some sense of wholeness or purpose. Then he goes off. Plot, plot. There is an amazing theologian, philosopher, priest in the Roman tradition, Father Richard Rohr. Some of you might know his writings. Amazing. And this is not a homework assignment. But I invite you to take one of these, pass it around. It's a why do you go to church question that I'm inviting each of you to think about and maybe even be able to respond to. Pass it around. And let me know if I missed something. I have enough. I didn't kill a whole lot of trees. I was intentional about that. You'll see a very short quote. Richard Rowe. Richard Rowe is well known. You've got enough for everybody. You'll see, we gather here as seekers, not for answers, not for doctrine, but a way of life inspired by the radical love of Jesus Christ. So that hit me after this conversation with the student about why I go to church. Not because I'm ordained, not because I'm trained professionally, all of that, yes, but why do I get up, not just today, but every time that I go rolling into a church or house of faith? Because that's part of my joy, is I get to go to Muslim community, Jewish communities, Hindus, Buddhists, all kinds of different folks that understand the holy, probably different than I do, but have some sense of experience of the holy. and are trying to live that out. So I wanted you to all have this because I think that there is a sense of some of the talking points that I'm going to get up on the pulpit now and think about with you are a response to that really heartfelt question by this young sophomore who was not raised in the church, who didn't have a clue on why someone would get out of bed on a Sunday and roll themselves into a beautiful congregation with amazing music. And I have the problem of going too long speaking. So, and you've got a great concert ahead, too. So if I start going too long, some of you can wait and say, shut up, Scott, it's time, close it. Because this is really a critical question for me. Why do you go? So I started going back and forth after Richard Rowe, after prayers, and then the text, then the text. The gospel text is about healing, and it's about these 10 lepers, people that have been, their bodies are in a mess of whatever that leprosy is. And it's not just metaphorically, it's very clear that to be a leper in that time, in that first century, would have been a pretty major stigma to be placed upon somebody. And it would limit your life. And then there's this engagement with Jesus, the radical lover, who heals and tells them to go to the priest. And I hope you caught the one that comes back. The one who comes back is a Samaritan. The one who comes back is an outsider, not a part of the community. The one who comes back probably is the recipient of first century racism. The one who came back to Jesus is the person who, gets it. They understand, he or she, whatever, that something happened, healed, and his responsibility, joy, hope, was to come back to Jesus. So kind of come back to church, come back to the synagogue, come back to faith. And Jesus even says, your faith has healed you. So it flips it from the action of the living God and Jesus into action of that person healed, who's an outsider. And so there's healing, and it's amazing. And perhaps all of us are stuck at times, metaphorically, with our own leprosy. And we're stuck trying to figure out meaning and purpose and direction and find hope. To come back to church, for me, is about trying to get reconnected to the source of love and to thank God, to worship, but also to get reconnected. So in the despair and frustration of the leprosy, there is a sense of diversity. There's a sense of diversity in that connection with someone who was outside, has been healed, and comes back to thank Jesus. And there is a unity in that diversity. They're not the same. They're different. And unity is not uniformity. Because we know that within the body of Christ, there's a lot of differences of opinion. And we sometimes hide that, or sometimes we really try to lean into that and say, help me understand, and work together to figure out how that diversity and unity might actually become manifest in the love, the radical love, of someone who's been healed and comes back to thank God. And Jesus says, your faith has made you well. But in a difference, and probably in a way of learning, all of our stories of leprosy, of brokenness, of diversity, of division, find their genesis in this gospel text. Somehow, I hope, I certainly heard an amazing word of hope and good news because 10 people are healed, one returns to give thanks, We don't know what happened to those other nine. Did they go back to synagogue, to church? Did they thank God? We don't know. But place the gospel text together with the Jeremiah text now. Because the Jeremiah text for me is a really critical piece. And you all know that at this time, Jeremiah is writing to the faithful, the Israelites, who are in exile. They have been run out of town, and they are in a foreign land. They themselves are the outsiders. And the city represents, as we all know, diversity, urban. And in that, Jeremiah invites, no, calls, charges, don't run away. Seek the welfare of that place that you are in, because in its welfare is yours. It is a profound conversation about the city, the place where you are in exile, dislocated. William Stringfellow, an amazing writer, wrote Stranger in a Strange Land. It's an older book, but it's about we who are in exile and that we are in a strange land. Now, I know Elmhurst is beautiful. It's absolutely wonderful home. But the city talks about helping people actually build, produce, unify, clarify, find hope, thrive. Not just hang out. There's an active engagement of the calling of Jeremiah, calling the people to make babies, to give yourself to that place that is foreign. And in some way, instead of running away from something, it is actually running towards something, running towards life and hope and well-being for all. Not just the faithful. And so Jeremiah takes the stuckness of what the lepers are about, or our own lives, when we are stuck, and says, look at the courage. Find the courage and strength to create, redeem, and sustain. Just as the divine source, Jesus, models for us. Just as the very God of history manifest in the Christ calls, invites, heals, and then receives us back to say, your faith has made you well. Go. So the reason to go to church on Sunday morning has something to do with our own leprosy and our own sense of our faith has made us well. But there is another part to this, and it has to do with what are we building? What are you building here at this beloved congregation? I see this in many ways often as inclusive, radically, globally engaged, and rooted in a prophetic tradition. The very roots of the living Christ are in the scriptures that are a part of a prophetic tradition. And we don't claim that enough. We have beautiful days like this with wonderful things. And somehow the seeking of the city, the role of the city, takes wholeness out of me individually into we the collective. And that we are invited, in fact called, to seek the welfare of others, because in their welfare, we find our own. I almost hear the words of Jesus, to find your life, you have to lose it. And in some fashion, seeking the welfare of the city invites us into, and some, I know there's a huge division and thought about this. Some people hate the city and want to get away into the beautiful burbs or rural. And so the text actually challenges us, why seek the welfare of that urban mess? seek welfare and to have a mission. So why go to church? I look forward to talking with you about that from your perspective. Let us pray. For the gifts that we are given in this wonderful congregation, this beautiful city, the community of Elmhurst, the town of Elmhurst, the city of Chicago, our nation, for all the gifts that are ever abundant, Lord, take our own needs for healing, the needs of a society for healing in the brokenness of our land, and to work together. To find by your Holy Spirit a way when there seems to be no way, and to give ourselves to the task daily of what it means to be healed and to heal others. Because we have been touched, we have been given grace to love, and we have been restored to walk in love. So may these here not just wrestle with questions and not with doctrine, but be followers of the risen Christ in radical love. In Christ's name. Today is a special day because we will be receiving our tithes and offerings in the context of an amazing musical moment. And so, beloved, in all the ways that you have been given time, talents, treasures, joys, strength of your mind and body, I invite you to receive and offer your tithes and offerings unto Almighty God.
I have asked the ushers to hold off on the plates until the gospel concert is complete. And I do want to introduce an amazing person who has joined us here this morning, and that's Dr. Stephanie Marshall. If you can please rise, Stephanie. Thank you. Now, for those who don't know her, look her up online. She has an amazing history. She has a great website, and what she's done in the world of education, psychology, child psychology, you can just go on and on. Anyways, I could go on and on about that, but what I will go on right now about is that Dr. Stephanie Marshall has donated this lovely piano to our congregation. It is a godsend on so many different levels. One, it's an amazing instrument to play as a pianist. I thoroughly enjoy playing it all the time at our church. But it also plays by itself. What you're going to see today is I have programmed it very much like I do on the organ in the back, right? It's the wonderful world of technology allows me to program instruments to play on their own, which allows me then to do something else like conduct the choir, which they appreciate because my little hands get to wave around. Anyway, so today's concert will be a lot of fun. If you're not watching the choir, we won't blame you, because once in a while you're going to be watching some keys moving all on their own, as if some ghost was playing and joining us this morning. Anyways, without further ado, our gospel, but we have some flowers as well. So Dr. Stephanie, could you please rise and accept these wonderful flowers on behalf of our church?
Songbook entitled Gospel Songs, a Choice Collection of Hymns and Tunes. It can mean two things. Peace will be obtained after death, which means when we will finally be with Jesus. The other is when we achieve peace here on earth by having faith in God.
Thank you.
While it has not been proven, it is believed that Wade in the Water was one of the songs associated with the Underground Railroad, a network of secret routes and safe houses used by slaves in the United States to find freedom. It is believed that Harriet Tubman, who made 13 trips to the South and helped free more than 70 people, used this song to warn slaves to get off the trail and into the water to prevent dogs used by the slavers from finding them. Our closing song features solos by Al Thurko and Michelle Myers.
Wade in the Water. our gifts of tithes and offerings, Almighty God, that we might sing for joy and love, we might help others to wade in the water, and that then in faithfulness, turn these as gifts. Return them to you and for others in your name, and for all the gifts that we have been given in this time and place. In Christ.
Standing, if you are able to join us for all verses of our closing hymn, number 546, Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
I wanted to get into the swing of it right away.
Yeah.
As almost like an attachment.
That's a good perfect, yeah, but I caught you.